Hi, welcome to Live in the Hall. I am Amy Henderson, Director of Marketing and Communications for the Georgia Municipal Association. And we are here at the Georgia Municipal Association's 83rd Annual Convention in Savannah, Georgia at the Trade Center. This is Kelly's first time
at the convention.
So give me some quick first impressions.
Oh my gosh, it's been so high energy. Like, you were right when you said don't wear heels, because I'm like running around everywhere, but it's awesome. I mean, I'm being able to connect names and faces to interviews and stories that we've done.
City officials.
Wow.
And today they had training, they had policy committee meetings, and then we just had a great message from Steve Gross with the Life is Good Foundation.
That was awesome.
And
so inspiring.
His message just really, I think, buoyed people up. And
right.
When you're in public office, I think a lot of times they hear, you know, a lot of complaints, lot of citizens have issues, and these are people who are elected to help, and I think hearing that message today really was a good one for them.
And even sitting out in the audience, you heard so many, oh my gosh, yes, and like everyone, it was just like a testament to really what they were supposed to do, so I thought it was awesome.
Yeah. And as you can see, we're here in the exhibit hall at the annual convention. We've got 196 different companies represented.
Wow.
Yeah, it's huge this year. And you know, I don't think you really realize all the issues that cities face until you walk around here and see all the products and services that are designed to help cities. And you're like, oh, I never even thought about that being an issue. So it's going to be a great couple of days. We just kicked off the opening session this afternoon. Kelly's going to introduce us to some of the vendors that are here. We're going to have a great lineup of guests who are going to talk about some of the issues that cities are facing, some of the things that we're doing here this weekend, and we appreciate you guys joining us.
Yep. So, sounds good. Yep. Off to the vendors.
Let's have some fun. And welcome back. I'm Amy, and this is Live in the Hall at the Georgia Municipal Association Annual Convention. And I am joined by Mayor Boyd Austin, Mayor of Dallas, Georgia, who is going to be sworn in as president of the association tomorrow afternoon. So, Boyd, you've been around GMA a lot. You've been super involved, and we really, really appreciate that. How did you first get involved with GMA?
Well, I've been involved with GMA since I became mayor.
And that was, what, 12?
21 years ago.
And numbers were first.
Right. And I found out early that GMA provided a lot of the resources that we needed as local cities, that they already had dealt with some of the issues that cities face, and there was no need to try to reinvent the wheel or spend money to do something again. So I was always very involved with them early on, and then began to move in leadership positions, legislative policy council, and executive board, and places like that. And the RMEBs
system. I was going to say, you're one of the few, it's only been, what, three in the history of GMA, presidents of the Georgia Municipal Association, also served as chairman of the employee benefits system as well.
That's
correct. You have double duty this year. We're going to keep you really, really busy. What are some of your plans for the year?
Well, I want to stress education. I want to stress the fact that city officials need to know what their role is, whether they're a mayor or council or an appointed official. I want them to take advantage of the services GMA offers. I want them to understand that if they've been here a short time or a long time, our training goes a long way to help improve their lives and their roles as city officials.
Well, in your 21 years, I'm sure you have seen the amount of training that GMA offers just explode.
It has, and you know, things have changed.
Yeah.
We're live streaming today on Facebook. We would never have imagined this even 10 years ago.
You know, people who took municipal operations, you know, 3 years ago, it's a completely different course now than it was when they took it.
And the city of Dallas, we just rolled out a new Dallas GA app. It's available in the Google and the Apple Store. People will be able to get notifications of city events. They can file work requests, pay their bills online, buy tickets for our theater. It's amazing what that platform does. It totally changes the way the government operates.
Technology has really changed
the
way government serves. And it also, I think, has changed people's expectations of government, too. They expect a much quicker response and to be much more connected to you.
And that's exactly what it does, is it moves from an old paper and phone system. They get notice that it's been received, when it's worked, and when it's completed, and it follows the whole process through.
So what I'm always interested because I don't think I could ever put myself out there to run for office. So I'm always interested. What made you decide you wanted to run for mayor? What got you involved?
Dallas is my hometown, and at the time I ran, there was a little bit of fussing going on the council, and the town I didn't think was being kept as clean and as nice as it should have been. And when I complained, somebody said, we ought to run, so I did.
That's what you get for complaining.
And I won. I defeated an incumbent, mm-hmm. and then they've elected me 5 times since then.
And I have to say, if you haven't been to Dallas, Georgia recently, your downtown is gorgeous. What you've done with the courthouse square area is just really, really pretty.
We're very pleased. We've had great partners. A lot of folks that are vendors here have been architects and the mm-hmm. construction companies, the contractors that did the mm-hmm. work. And so it's been a real community partnership. And what it's done, it's like you'll see all over Georgia that people are coming to spaces in downtown, mm-hmm. gathering spaces. And we didn't have that before.
Right.
And so now they've got 2 great little parks. We hope to build more. We've connected the neighborhoods with sidewalks.
And you brought your theater back.
The theater was bought, renovated and restored. Mm-hmm. So it provides a gathering place after business hours, and it gives impetus for other things to come.
Okay, so I'm going to jump to policy real quick.
Okay.
You are such a proponent of home rule. Explain to people what home rule means, because I think it's those of us who work in the policy area, it's kind of like, oh yeah, home rule. You know, it's like ketchup. We know what that means. Well, what does it mean?
Well, home rule, we've got a great example now with the Brexit vote. Home rule is the individual freedom of self-determination to be what you want to be and how you want to be. And it's manifested in a local level, at the government local level, as mm-hmm. home rule. For us to make decisions for ourselves, to know that each of us is unique as a city right. from other cities. And then that grows into the state's rights, where states have certain powers enumerated to them. And then it's national sovereignty.
Right.
So it's a step process. But home rule says we can do things better at the local level than some higher level of government can do for us.
I
am a staunch defender. I've got a populist background, and that's one thing I'll talk about uh-huh. tomorrow, is that I am a staunch defender of home rule and that we should have that ability to make decisions. And that's really the reason why GMA was founded.
Exactly.
Those 35 city officials that came together in 1933 mm-hmm. Came together for that purpose, is to say we can do these things on our own.
We understand the needs at the local level.
Right.
And, you know, Brunswick is different than Beaufort. They're
right.
not the same. They have different issues. That's right.
There are a lot of similarities in cities. We have a mm-hmm. lot of the same issues, but there are different scales and mm-hmm. there are different means that we have for going about. Some cities have utilities that pay a huge portion of their finances,
right.
and then other cities depend heavily on property taxes.
Okay, so I'm gonna toss this out to you. What do you think are some of the biggest challenges that cities in Georgia face?
I think we have a serious crisis in infrastructure, and that's proven nationally. Transportation, water and sewer infrastructure, mm-hmm. A lot of the safety issues regarding the power grid. On a local level and on a state level, we have some issues about providing broadband service
right.
to local communities, and who can provide it, who will provide
right.
it,
right.
and at what cost it will be provided. We're moving more towards social issues.
Mm-hmm.
We talk about the opioid abuse and
right.
some of the responses we've had to that. So, and it's in every community,
yes.
large and small.
It is.
But
yeah.
it will affect all of us, whether we're big or small or rural or urban or suburban.
Yeah. And what do you think makes Georgia's cities great? And you've traveled quite a bit, I know, to other states as part of your responsibilities with GMA and with the RMEPS board, and you've visited other communities. What do you think makes Georgia's cities different than the cities in other states?
Well, I will tell you this. There are 49 municipal leagues across mm-hmm. the country. And all but Hawaii has a municipal league.
We got to get them on board.
That's right. But as we travel around and we meet with people from different states, we find that Georgia is the envy of all of them. Our advocacy section at GMA, which provides our support in the legislature and in the United States Capitol,
right,
is second to none. We provide a wide range of services, and through our Member Services Advisory Council now, we're growing, and we're assessing the services mm-hmm. we provide, looking at things we need to do and maybe some things we should get rid of.
Right.
So we're really answering the needs of Georgia cities. Mm-hmm. And I think that that is the basis of the foundation for the success. And cities are where things happen.
Yep.
We're the traditional site for new ideas, for manufacturing. We're the markets for our agricultural products. Mm-hmm. We're the port city, mm-hmm. both in Savannah and Atlanta with Hartsfield. So we all have unique character, but we have a great common bond through GMA, and that's something I want to see grow.
That's awesome.
Over my next year as president, right, and then even beyond that with those that follow me.
Well, we appreciate you being here. We look forward to your presidency, and we look forward to having fun this weekend. One of the things we love about the GMA convention is even though we stay very busy with training and policy and all the meetings that we do over these 3-4 days, it is kind of have a family reunion. It's all the city officials coming back together once a year and just reconnecting with each other.
It's fun and fellowship. And while we learn from a lot of the things we read and see and mm-hmm. hear, we share a lot of ideas and we get so much from each other. And GMA is a family. Yeah, we're kind of like preachers. We steal a lot of our messages and the things we do. So it's a great event. And I would encourage every city to make sure that GMA's convention and Mayor's Day is a part of your budget.
Right.
The training is a vital factor in your success. Take advantage of what the association has to offer.
Well,
Be a part of it.
Thank you so much, and we look forward to seeing you get sworn in tomorrow.
Thank you. I'm looking forward to it as well.
And now we're going to go check out some of the vendors with Kelly.
I am here with Jay Andrews of Next Generation Lighting. Hi, Jay. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. How are you?
I'm awesome. Tell me a little bit about Next Generation Lighting.
Yeah, sure. Next Generation Lighting is we represent about 90 manufacturers who sell energy efficient LED lighting and controls. And so what we do is we assist both corporate customers and then cities and communities who are interested in saving a lot of energy. Energy is a major cost to communities. Mm-hmm. And so by changing out their lighting to LED lighting, not only is it more efficient, but they save on operation and maintenance because it lasts so long.
Wow. So can you kind of describe what LED is?
Sure. LED lighting has been around for probably 6 years now. Okay. It's really now becoming mainstream. We're starting to see cities and communities across the country and around the world starting to convert all of their lighting to LED lighting. Wow. It's the most energy efficient lighting possible. It also provides a better quality of light. So whether that's a community center, whether that's a park and recreation, or the streets within a community, we can now change those out to LEDs.
Wow, so you named some projects that cities are kind of implementing the LED lighting. What are some other ways that you're seeing cities implement this type of lighting?
Well, one of the things that we're extremely excited about is wireless controls. So what that allows somebody to do is actually change the lights on their streets. They incorporate the wireless controls and allow somebody maybe in the police department or the city public works department to adjust the lighting on the streets. They can schedule the lights to come up for events, for football games or baseball games or whatever, parades or whatever the case may be. They can do all that from their laptop. They don't have to go out to the facility or do any of that stuff. Absolutely.
Awesome. So as far as like when people go to kind of choose an LED distributor, what are some things you say look for, some tips you would give them, some city officials?
Yeah, absolutely. So you want to look at manufacturers who've been around for quite a while. There's a lot of this industry with LED lighting. There's a lot of new companies that not everybody has heard of. So we represent our main line is Cree LED Lighting, and they were actually the founders of it. They actually make the LEDs, and so they've been around for now 8 or 9 years making this product. We've got installations throughout Georgia, both in the school systems and county buildings. We're actually renovating Atlanta City Hall with these LED lighting. Like today, it's an ongoing project. So we're starting to see more and more convert.
Awesome, awesome. So what's your website? Where can people find you?
Absolutely. It's www.nextgenltg.com. And we actually have two offices in the state. Okay. We have a northern office in Alpharetta that covers basically just north of Macon to the Tennessee line. And then we have an office really close by in Statesboro that covers the southern half of the state.
Well, great. Thank you so much. You all come over and visit Next Generation Lighting at Booth 732. We're going to head on over to our next vendor. Thank you, Jay. Thank you. We're going to go to GovPay Networks. We are here live in the hall. Excuse me. So we're going to go over here and see what they have to offer our cities. Alrighty. As you can see, we have so many vendors, so many exhibitors. Excuse me. Alrighty. Excuse me. We have some play over here. All right, we're coming right up on GovPay Networks. Hey, GovPay, we're here for a quick interview. Hi. All right, hi, Tony, how are you?
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. I'm Kelly. We're here with, we have Live in the Hall. So we want to learn a little bit more about GovPay Networks. This is Tony here. Tell us who you are with the company and more about the company.
I am the CEO of GovPay Network. We created an online portal for credit card payments for municipalities, small, medium, and even the large ones. We've been around for about 10 years now and growing. Our payment platform is unique in that you can take payments in person, online, or even over the telephone. It's absolutely free, 100% free to all municipalities. We never charge you a dime. There's no annual fee. There's no monthly fee. If a defendant owes $100, guess what? You're going to get that $100. You never have to worry about paying Visa or MasterCard or any of those fees. You never have to worry about data breaches. You know, nowadays, everything's all about security and how good security is. All that is a liability shift onto my company, GovPay Network. We are responsible 100% for all transactions. So the municipality is immediately removed from that scenario. So they can take payments 24 hours a day and never have to worry about anything.
Right. So what would you say to some of those smaller cities or even mid-sized cities that say, oh, I don't need a service like that? What kind of encouragement would you give them to have a service like GovPay Networks?
Well, I would compare it to the smartphones nowadays versus the flip phones. It's technology that's always evolving.
Right.
Eventually, one day, your citizens are going to want a better way to pay. Mm-hmm. And guess what? Sometimes somebody doesn't have the cash to pay that electric bill or to pay that court fee. And they have to lean on their credit cards, for example. And what better way to offer them a free service online or even over the phone where they can resolve their issues immediately? Every city needs it. Even the smaller ones that were opposed to it in the beginning, they thank us. And we've been around 10 years, and I think we've our retention rate's about 98%.
Oh, wow. Congratulations.
Yeah.
So why GovPay? I mean, of course, there's some competitors, but what makes GovPay stand out?
GovPay was built not with what I thought the clerks would find interesting or what would like. We built this software from the ground up with input from the clerks, and it is always evolving every single year. At least 3 or 4 times a year, we reach out to them and say, hey, how could we make your life easier? What could we do to make our software a little bit better? We take all of that input, and we actually are always improving on our software. We're always staying on top of the compliance. We're always staying on top of security measures. We are always cutting edge. And that's very, very important, especially when you're talking about software.
Yeah, I agree. So is there any? Where can we find you? Where's your website? Anything else you want to add?
Sure. You can find us at govpaynetwork.com. That's GovPayNetwork. govpaynetwork.com. Our two products are court pay and utility pay, but we will also build free of charge customized payment pages for any need whatsoever in the municipality.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much, Tony. It was great learning about GovPay Networks. Have a great time here at convention.
Thank you very much.
You're
take
welcome.
Care.
Bye. Thank you. All righty. Those are our first two vendors. We'll have a lot more.
Thanks, Kelly. It seems like there is a lot of excitement out there in the exhibit hall. So many things to see and to experience. Thank you for bringing us some of the exhibitors. There's something I'm really excited about. I've been following in the newspapers, and that is this broadband initiative that Donaldsonville, Georgia is doing. They're trying to make Donaldsonville a smart rural city. And with me is Mayor Dan Ponder. And Dan, this was kind of your brainchild, and you're working with some companies to bring broadband to your, and for those of you who aren't familiar with Donaldsonville, it's
the county seat of Seminole County. It's in the very southwest corner of the state.
It's
right above Lake Seminole, where the Chattahoochee River and Flint River come
together. God's country is where it is.
Absolutely God's country.
Dan, what are some of the challenges? And I find this interesting because I think especially people who live in urban areas in the metro Atlanta area don't comprehend what it's like where you don't have easy access to high-speed internet and broadband. What are some of the challenges your community faces without broadband?
Well, we have broadband in the center of the city, of course, and in most of the city it's available, but not necessarily high speed. And and then of course the further away you get from the city out into the real rural areas of the county, it gets further poorer and poorer until it's just practically non-existent. And so the things that you take for granted in everyday life, and especially as the population has moved to smartphones, and all you have to do is walk around this hall and see how many people are on their smartphone, you realize how connected we are. Mm-hmm. And so that's why it's important for rural America, rural mm-hmm. communities, to figure out a way that they can participate in this explosion.
And what you guys are doing, my hope is that it's something that can be replicated. And I know it's kind of, this is a test kind of for the companies and for you as well.
Right. I mean, our initial premise is what would happen if you brought world-class internet to a rural city and made it available to every citizen. So that's the kind of premise of the experiment.
Some of the things that you guys have done. I mean, you guys had a Net Days to show people what it's like. And what were some of the activities?
The purpose of Net Days was to actually validate, is it feasible that to do certain things with high-speed internet in a less controlled situation, but also would people buy into it? Would the community itself respond to the kinds of things that could happen? And so we did a variety of things, from streaming in movies to have movie nights. We had, particularly with the school system, because education is a big part of the possibilities, we actually had, for instance, a world-famous photographer that is world-famous about Antarctica. I mean, and if you follow penguins and all the wildlife in Antarctica.
Cool.
And so she's in California while we have an interactive discussion with a fifth grade class. And the technology that's available today is just extraordinary.
It's amazing.
And good enough that she could recognize kids in the back of the class raising their hand. And so it's not a one-way stream, it's a dual stream. We also did things where we had concerts, where we had, and my particular favorite was we had two music professors, actually from the University of South Alabama, playing Mozart's concerto for four hands, so two pianos, 300 miles apart, playing in real time.
And it was seamless and wonderful.
Yes.
And so the community has responded.
The community has. Our first Net Day, we had about 150 there. The second Net Days, we had about 500 people there. We had to move it. And in that one, we actually had interaction with in China. Mm-hmm. We had a children's choir performing for Douglasville. Douglasville performing for multiple places in China.
So the cultural exchange, the educational exchange, and of course the issue of healthcare as well.
Telemedicine is a huge opportunity.
Yeah.
We're fortunate to have a very good hospital in Donaldsonville, but even the equipment in even the most basic doctor's offices are being designed in a way that
they require large.
Larger and larger.
Data pipes, I guess, is the best way to explain
it. That's right. It's one way to explain it.
So who are the companies that you guys are working with?
Well, Huawei is the primary.
That's just fun to say, too.
Right, right. It's it's the largest telecommunications company in the world. It's not very well known, especially in a retail sense here in the United States.
Right.
But they provide telecommunications and switches and infrastructure around the world, very well known. And we work with Sozo Solutions, which is a company that actually works to facilitate opportunities between companies in China and companies in the United States. That's how the project got started in the first place. We're now also working with Emphasys, which is an Indian company, and it has $9 billion in sales. Huawei is about $62 billion. So they're large companies, hundreds of thousands of employees. Emphasys is helping us to try to design an app, because it's not enough just to have fast a fast connection. It's what do you do with it, and how do people access it? And so we're hoping that we can come up with what is truly the first rural city smart app that will push certain sort of educational things and content that we're trying to build that will lift the city up socially.
Right. And what do you think the economic impact will be for the city? With
Well, it is really not about the internet. Mm-hmm. It is about making your city more competitive as a rural city, but also creating a culture where companies that don't want to live in a city of 5 million people but do want to have that kind of access might be interested in looking. And I can tell you that, you know, it is certainly, even though we haven't gone live, it has put Douglasville on the map. And amazingly, it's not companies from China. It's the companies are from all over the world who have an interest in what we're doing.
Right.
And whether all that pans out from an economic development standpoint is yet to be seen, but certainly we're having conversations weren't having a year
ago. I mean, because then you could live in God's country.
That's right.
And work there and be connected to, if you work for a company in France, you could be in the best place in the world. And
that's exactly right.
And work for a company, you know, across the globe. What is the timeline on this?
We have put what made Donaldsonville a good test site is it's a small community, small footprint. Mm-hmm. It's flat. And we had strategically placed water towers that would cover the entire city. And we had a few pine trees, believe it or not, which soaks up the microwaves. And
I didn't know that.
So even though we live in a place where there are a lot of pine trees within the city limits, there really weren't as many as you might expect. And so those four factors went together. Mm-hmm. We have completed the installation of the equipment on the water towers. We've completed the installation of, in a layman's term, the computer towers within City Hall that are driving all this. And we now have, although it's not available to the public yet, we have the Wi-Fi around City Hall and in downtown. And so what's happening now is we're working to make it available throughout the city. We're starting to turn on segment by segment or neighborhood by neighborhood, if you will. So we hope to have that over the next 3 months.
Wow.
So we have made a lot of progress in
that's
the past
great.
Year.
And people just, are you hearing a lot of comments about it?
We hear a lot of comments. You know, people's vision of the internet or broadband or even an app is based on their own experience. Mm-hmm. And so we're trying to broaden that. We're holding town hall meetings and a lot of outreach things.
Well, and you guys have the Bainbridge College satellite campus there in downtown Donaldsonville.
Right.
And I'm sure this will be useful for those students as well. So it's not just elementary, it's high school, it's college.
That's correct. And we're also working with other universities who have similar technology to bring in classes that perhaps wouldn't be available through Bainbridge College.
That's amazing.
It really opens up the world.
Yeah.
To more specialized things.
And how will it just be within the city, or will it extend out from the city limits?
Well, you know, to make this sustainable long term, we either the city has to support it through tax dollars, or we've migrated in our business model. Initially, it was going to be free to everyone, and now we have have a hybrid model where certain businesses or individuals might pay for it, and we think it'd be competitive and very high speed and reliable, but also it would be free to people who did certain things or had certain needs. For instance, if you didn't graduate from high school and you took GED classes, you could get free Wi-Fi, or if you're a single parent.
So you're incentivizing further education,
because,
too.
And I say all the time, it's not just about the internet.
It's not. It's a tool that gets you somewhere else.
That's right.
That's great. Right. And you're presenting at one of the rapid fire sessions on Monday,
On Monday.
Yes.
I'm going to take about a 3-hour discussion and try to condense it into 7 minutes.
So I'm like, that's really tough. But I'm so excited. I can't wait to see how this turns out. And, you know, I think, you know, when you look around the state and you see the need for high-speed internet and the choices that companies and families and individuals make about where they're going to locate, and that is one of the things that they look at. And I think, you know, what you guys are doing, especially if it's something that can be recreated elsewhere, it would be just amazing.
Well, we realize that we are a test for these companies and really for ourselves, and hopefully It'll be replicated because the need for high-speed broadband in rural Georgia and really rural America is only going to continue to increase.
Because you're already a little bit behind the curve and you don't want to get further.
That's right. Well, we don't want to get further behind. We actually want to catch up and pass.
You want to be the leaders.
That's right.
Yeah. Well, I'm so excited about what you guys are doing, and thank you for joining us today.
Well,
and I'm going to be keeping my eye on what's going on with that.
We'll look forward to having you to Donaldsonville and check it out yourself.
Yes, I'll have phone reception and I can search Google.
That'll
be great.
There we go.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
We're going to go back out to Kelly in the hall and meet some more of our vendors.
I am here with Whit Alexander of Los & Associates, Inc. How are you today?
Doing great. How are you?
I'm awesome. Thank you. So let's talk a little bit more about your company and kind of the benefit it has on cities.
Okay. Our company is Los & Associates. We're landscape architects, civil engineers, architects, all of that in one shop.
Okay.
So when a city comes to us, we can offer all the services they need for their project. And we're small. We're smaller than a lot of the bigger guys, which means we can give a much more custom touch to a project. When you work with us, you know that you're going to work with the seasoned principals of the firm, that they're going to be the main people in charge of your project and taking care of you and your project until it's finished.
Awesome. So how long have you all been in existence?
We've been in business now for 34 years.
Wow.
And we've been here in Georgia working for projects for over 30 years, but we've had our office in the Atlanta area for over 15 years.
And what are some of the projects that you worked on? I know you said you have over 30 projects across the state of Georgia. Can you name a couple?
More than that, over 300 across
the state. Oh, I missed a zero. So, yes, over 300. Can you kind
Correct.
Of give us some of the biggest projects, the most memorable in your mind?
Right now we're working on some projects. I've got one in Valdosta, a large soccer complex, and some trails that we're doing for those guys. We have some projects in Ackworth, so we work for big cities and small cities. We do some work for Gwinnett County quite a bit. We do a lot of trail planning for them right now, for greenways that connect various cities together. Trying to think what else in the state we've got going. We've got maybe five or six projects going across the state right now.
So you mentioned, obviously, the art convention is Cities in Play. And so you mentioned a little bit about the trail planning. Why is it important for a city to really bring in experts like yourself when planning a trail and those greenways that connect?
We can think outside the box a little bit. We can, a trail, if you have to connect two or three cities together and some of the places where you have to put a trail or maybe the leftover bits that nobody else can build on. And so we kind of thread through the needle of taking the trail in places. And if you've experienced it, done it before, you can see places where you can take trails that maybe other firms can't.
Awesome. So you kind of have like that experience. I mean, you've worked with so many different places. Now, where else are you at in the nation?
Well, our other offices are in Tennessee, but that doesn't mean that that's our two places we work.
Right.
Our Atlanta office works on projects. We have a project in New York right now, North Carolina, Louisiana. So we cover pretty much the whole eastern half of the U.S. from our Gwinnett County office.
Awesome, awesome. So can you tell everyone where they can find you online?
Sure. Our web address is losassoc.com. That's losassoc.com.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much, Whit. I will definitely tell people to come by and definitely the importance of you. So we're going to head over to the next exhibitor.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. All right, we're going to go over here to Mobile Town Guide, see what they have to talk to us about. Hey, guys, how are you?
How are you?
Good, good. So we're here with Remington with Mobile Town Guide. Tell us a little bit about Mobile Town Guide.
Well, Mobile Town Guide is a mobile app for cities. It's kind of like an electronic brochure. It's got a full guide to the town, events calendars, walking tours, directory listings, coupons, pretty much anything you want to put in there. Yeah.
Awesome. So what are some cities across Georgia that is utilizing Mobile Town Guide?
Hartwell, Georgia, Fitzgerald, Conyers, Old Fourth Ward, a bunch of cities. Yeah.
Awesome. So what would you say to those smaller cities, mid-sized cities who say, oh, a phone app, I don't need that?
Well, it's a lot like an electronic brochure. So if you guys are capable and ready for doing brochures, you're pretty much ready for a mobile app. It costs about the same, only it's something you guys can update for free. You don't have to pay for reprinting costs and stuff like that. Yeah.
Awesome. So what have you seen has been like? Obviously, the cost is a big thing. But what are some other benefits of cities implementing these mobile apps?
You're capturing a different generation, a different kind of person that doesn't necessarily go to a visitor station and grab pamphlets. If you've noticed, just look around. People are looking at their phones to try to find information these days, and the faster they can find the information, the better. Even a Google search, if they can't find it on that first O in Google, they're done. So we're trying to put it right in the palm of their hands. It's easy. It's native on their phone. They've got an app right there on their phone. It's got everything that they would be looking for. Yeah.
Okay. So with working in Georgia, what has been kind of your favorite project or even your favorite part of working with developing?
Every city is so unique that all of our apps are different. People can, you guys can even make changes to the app after it's built, so they can go in there and customize it and change things. And it's just nice to see all the different history, building walking tours for the different cities and stuff, and just kind of seeing, it's just cool to see all the different unique cities around. Yeah.
I think you mentioned something really important about, customizing. There's some people that are kind of like, nervous, like, I don't really know that much technology to be able to implement it. So how involved are you all after the launch of the app with the city?
The way the app is set up, it's like a platform that we've already built. So it's not a long turnaround time to build an app. Okay, it takes us about 3 to 5 days. And it's done. And so then we launch it in the stores. So you guys have an app that's free to download within a month. It's ready inside app stores. And then they can make changes to it whenever they want to. So they can customize it and make changes to it and things like that. And I'm getting off track here.
No, you're fine. Yeah. So tell us a little bit where we can find you, your website, if, city's officials are now like, I want an app right now.
Okay, so Mobile Town Guide, just go to mobiletownguide.com and you can find us there. Yeah.
Okay. Well, thank you so much, Remington. It was great.
I appreciate it.
No, yeah.
Take care.
Thank you. All righty.
Thanks, Kelly, and welcome back to Live in the Hall. I am Amy, and this is the Georgia Municipal Association annual convention. And with me is John Pinkerton, owner of the Blue Moon Brew Pub and Brewery or Brew House?
Moon River Brewing Company.
Brewing Company. I don't know why I want to keep changing your title. It's horrible. But you've been brewing now. We're talking off air about 17 years?
17 years, April 10th, 1999.
And which is kind of, to me, a little bit amazing because I feel like this is something that just happened like in the last 5-6 years. But you've been at it for a while.
Yeah, back when we started, they still referred to the Southeast as the final frontier of craft brewing.
Okay.
But now things are, happening at a, pretty good clip.
And this was one of the topics at one of our policy committee meetings today was the breweries and some of the, I guess, differing laws that affect the wineries, the brewing house, brewing companies, and then the other companies. What do you see as some of the challenges for the industry that you're in?
Here in Georgia or
yes.
just?
Well, yeah, let's start here in Georgia and then we'll go global.
I think the biggest challenge here in Georgia is just trying to get everybody's perspective adjusted kind of to the rest of the country because we've got so much potential here.
Right.
But we're still a long ways behind many other states. And in fact, just the surrounding states around Georgia, and I never imagined I would say this, but South Carolina is kicking our butt. Alabama is kicking our butt.
We cannot let this happen.
Well, it's already happened, but we can dig out.
What got you interested in doing this? How did you get involved? How did you get started?
Really, it just comes down to booze.
I have to say, I made a C in chemistry, and my dad is a biochemist, so it was a very shameful family secret. But the one experiment I did do well was the fermenting.
There you go. Well, I mean, honestly, I started doing a lot better in biology and chemistry when I started putting it in the context of a brewing
science. How you can use this in real-life applications.
Absolutely. And, of course, my whole family is like civil engineers. Both of my grandfathers were civil engineers, and they said, you need to study civil engineering. And I said, yeah, right, whatever. And then as soon as I started brewing, I was like, wow, I should have studied some kind of engineering.
So 17 years ago, what were you doing before that?
I was brewing in Maryland.
Okay.
Which, at the time was fighting their own battles. But even there, there were a lot of things on the table that still aren't on the table here in Georgia.
Okay.
17 years ago.
So we are really pretty far behind where everybody else is.
I think the best way to put it in perspective is to look at South Carolina right now.
Mm-hmm.
South Carolina has really seized the opportunity to attract mm-hmm. breweries
right.
and that potential for economic development there by changing the laws, allowing for some even limited direct sales
right.
From a brewery to the consumer.
Mm-hmm. Well, and you mentioned economic development. I think for a lot of our cities, they're seeing the economic development tourism opportunities that breweries, brew pubs bring to a community. Can you talk about that a little bit? I mean, you're also in the guild as well, correct?
Correct.
Former president.
I was the founding president / chairman, whatever. And now I'm relatively uninvolved, although...
you still get called in to do stuff like this.
Absolutely. Why not? I think it's apropos that you mentioned this because I'm driving my daughter to a camp up in near Asheville, North Carolina tomorrow mm-hmm. morning. And even as a brewmaster in this industry, I'm going to end up going to at least two or three breweries while
right.
I'm there to see friends. But I'm not unique here. I mean, there are more breweries at one time there were more breweries just in the city of Asheville than there were in the entire state of Georgia.
Wow.
That has since changed.
Right.
But
how many are there in Georgia now? Do you know? Guesstimate?
I think that there are 50, around 50,
mm-hmm.
If I'm not mistaken. But just to put that in perspective, in the city of Chicago, there are 68 in one city.
That's,
so,
you know,
the potential is enormous.
Right. And what would you advise that for a city official, if they're interested in something, you know, in attracting a brewery, what are some tips?
Well, I think the most powerful thing is to put the pressure on state leadership
mm-hmm.
to get some of these efforts, you
mm-hmm.
know, say the guild.
Right.
I mean, we're trying to put things out there that are responsible, careful changes
right.
to the law, nothing radical, things that are being done or have been done for decades in other states. We're just trying to get some things out there. And so my recommendation would be to put the pressure on our state officials to look at these carefully and recognize that how powerful this is.
Mm-hmm.
And there's all kinds of resources that they can look at as well. I mean, you can look at the Brewers Association. That's our national trade organization.
Okay.
And they've got tons of resources. And those people go to speak to conferences like this all the time to talk about this potential.
What do you think the attraction is for tourists? Why would a tourist be interested in going and... I mean, I know I have my own personal beliefs on this, having been a tourist.
You know, one of the things, I'll kind of put this in a different light
okay.
here. What we sell as a brew pub, what Moon River sells, and what a lot of breweries sell, is an opportunity to kind of slow down, take your time, you know, enjoy
it's an
the...
experience.
It's an experience, but, you know, not that we're pushing booze.
Right.
I mean, we are in a sense, but you know, there's something about relaxing and having a beer mm-hmm. with family or friends or what have you. There's a certain context to that that really just works. And
mm-hmm.
and so you go to see a brewery that's a manufacturing environment, it's kind of a spectacular, you know, visual display of
right.
machinery and engineering and fun, you
yeah.
know. So that's, I think, I don't know, that's, it's, I guess maybe it's not for everybody, but that's what drew me into the brewing industry from the beginning. I mean, I said booze, but really, it was from the moment that I first walked into a brewery and saw all that stainless steel and the pipes and the
right.
tanks. That's...
And this has been my observation in visiting. I just mentioned I was over in Birmingham recently, and there's three or four that are like in close proximity, and it's just an amazing experience. You can see the whole operations. So it's like, oh, like you say, it's a stainless steel, and that's really cool. And then picnic tables sitting around, you know, sitting out there, and people sitting around, and food trucks pull up, and it's just very relaxed, and there's games and that type of stuff that people can play. There's a great sense of camaraderie, I think, too. And
yeah,
it's,
I was going to say community.
Yes, and it's, again, it's not about the alcohol so much as it is seeing people in this park-like event. I mean,
yeah, I think community is a very important part of this.
Mm-hmm.
Breweries are part of that community, and people come together to gather.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's one piece of it. I think another piece of it is that, you know, it's kind of a sign of the times, really. We really like to see things being made
mm-hmm.
by hand.
Right.
We like to see things being made right here in our own backyard.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we like to see things being made kind of from start to finish, because so much of what we...
consume.
Eat, yeah.
Yes.
Whether it's eat, drink, even, you know, cars, you name it, whatever
right.
it is, that's all being done somewhere else. And it's almost a mystery. And so when you go to a brewery, A lot of times when you go to a brewery for a tour, you're watching the bottles whiz by and you're seeing some guy in the back, you know, with connecting hoses, and you get the whole sight and smell and sound and
do you think
the whole experience.
The movement with the farm to table also is part of that as well. That kind of impacts that as well. People like that concept of, okay, so this cucumber was grown here and this beer was grown here type.
I think that's certainly part of it. And I think that's, if you look closely at what's driving consumers today,
mm-hmm.
You know, and all this, you know, economic factors come into this, the millennial generation, like what
yes.
does the millennial generation want? You always come back to these things like local, mm-hmm. Affordable luxuries. Like, mm-hmm. I can't afford to buy a boat this year, but I can go and get a really good cup of coffee. Or I can go to my local brew pub or brewery and I could buy, well, not in Georgia, I can't buy, but at the brew pub you can buy actual
right.
retail, you know, a $5 or $6 beer. That's an affordable luxury,
mm-hmm.
and I'm going to savor it. You know, it's going to be really, really good.
Really cool. And of course, a lot of the places are doing tours, and people like to see how it all comes together and the science behind it. Like, oh, this goes with this, and this goes here.
Absolutely.
So do you think that it's going to continue to grow? We're going to see this industry. Is Georgia going to catch up?
Georgia will catch up. I think what we worry about is an organization, the Guild, that mm-hmm. Is that, you know, we might hit a peak and things will start to recede because there's just not the opportunities for some of these smaller operations.
Okay.
You know, still, even with all the things that we just mentioned about market, what's driving the market, we still have limitations, economic limitations. We can't take advantage of those economies of scale that, you know, the big manufacturers
right.
can. You know, there's plenty of success stories out there, but, you know, the build it and they will come kind of days, I think, are long gone. I don't think you're going to see nearly as many huge craft breweries. The ones like, I mean, you can think of the kind of the icons of craft brewing now.
Right.
I don't think there's going to be that many of those anymore. And I think there's going to be lots
smaller.
More little ones. And if we don't take care, if we don't seize the opportunity to take care of these little operations,
mm-hmm.
I think we're losing something.
And
losing
for
some potential.
For cities where, you know, these little operations are probably going to be in their downtowns. Those are, you know, cities love their downtowns, and downtown economic development is huge. So
absolutely.
It's an opportunity to maybe cultivate some of that business as well. If
you know, you drive through the South, and there's just all these little small towns that have kind of, you can see that they were once, there was once something there,
right.
and now there's just kind of like a lot of empty storefronts. And I think that's an opportunity. You put a brew pub or a small brewing operation in something like that,
mm-hmm.
and I think, and there's plenty of examples of this. I mean, at this point, there are over 4,000 breweries across the country. Okay, you can probably look at the vast majority of those and see this very same success story playing out again and again and again. And in fact, the guy that actually helped us start Moon River Brewing Company, he was one of the great champions of this whole idea of going into a historic building. You know, there's this guy named John Hickenlooper. You know that name?
I don't know that name.
Well, he's the guy that introduced me and my business partner, Gene Biko. And at the time, he had this funky little brewery in lower downtown Denver.
Okay.
And at that time, lower downtown was kind of sketchy. I mean, it wasn't like, you know, it's all posh now.
Mm-hmm.
But there really wasn't anything down there except for his brew pub. Well, the Wind Coop has gone on to become a great
big,
you know, a landmark
yeah.
there. And things have grown up around it. In fact, now they have a ballpark right there, just down the street.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, lower downtown is thriving. As it turns out, John Hickenlooper eventually became the mayor of Denver, and we all thought that was hilarious. Like, wow, John a brewer is now the mayor of Denver. And then a little bit later, it turns out that he became the governor of Colorado.
I guess I probably should know that name then, huh?
Well,
my focus is so hyper local. It's all Georgia or nothing. No.
But I mean, this is
that's
a great
amazing.
Example.
Yeah.
I mean, he was one of those people in the very early days of brewpubs.
Kind of saw
in this
that visionary too along.
And
those.
He told us what to do. He's like, you need to do this.
That's great.
And
are you helping others now too? You've been in this a long time. Are you nurturing, mentoring, bringing on others?
I try to. You know, you get involved with trade organization stuff, and you know, by the time your leadership term is up, everybody's sick to death of you. So, well, and then there's that. I've kind of, since I've stepped down from the board and all that, I've kind of, I've gotten back to focusing on my own business.
Well, we appreciate you coming over here so much, and we look forward to maybe checking it out across the river while we're here this weekend.
Absolutely. Well, I know that this event has really brought a lot of business to us. We've been getting crushed all weekend.
Good.
Which
I'm
is
so
great,
glad to hear that. You know, we like to support the local economy wherever we go.
Keep crushing.
Thanks, John, so much. And we will be right back with Kelly for a close on today's Live in the Hall.
Thank you.
We are back, and we are about to say goodbye, but before we do, we have to introduce one of the newest members of the GMA family, and we talk a lot about GMA being a
family
organization, and with us is Mike Bodker, mayor of Johns Creek, current GMA president.
Yes.
Tomorrow will be your last day. You've had a pretty big year. Introduce us to this beautiful young lady.
I brought with me this year Emma-Kate Bodker. And I started the year of my presidency getting married, and I ended the year apparently allowed to be here because she decided to come 4 weeks early.
That is awesome, and she's beautiful, and of course she's got her GMA onesie on.
Absolutely.
We believe in branding early and often. So.
She does too, because the first onesie she wore, she soiled.
Good job, Emma. Good job, good girl. She is so beautiful. Congratulations on her, and
yes,
a great year. It's been fun with you, and I know you're not going far because you've been involved with GMA since you took office 10 years ago, and we know that you will continue to be involved.
We have a phenomenal organization, and everyone should stay very, very much involved in this organization.
And, okay, she's a baby now, so 18 years she can run for mayor. So we look forward to having Emma-Kate as a delegate in whatever year that is, 18 years from now.
We're writers, so you can do that.
Yeah, we don't do math, not our strong suit. But join us tomorrow. We're going to pick back up again here live in the hall around 8:30 in the morning and meet some more of our vendors. Kelly, you introduced us to some great ones today. We look forward to seeing some new ones tomorrow and some other guests who are going to be presenting here at the convention over the next couple days. Thanks and have a great afternoon.